So we have Professor Ruth Halperin-Kaddari from Bar-Ilan University School of Law and Professor David Kretzmer from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem School of Law, and they'll present on religious parties, the exclusion, again, of women and freedom of religion and press.
Okay, thank you very much. We are going to be dealing with a specific case of a general problem, which is been the problem on the table here through these 3 days. And that is, what happens when you have a clash between religious values, which are discriminatory by their very nature, and the liberal democratic values, especially in the case of a democratic process? And we're going to be dealing with a specific case which arose 2 months ago during the Israeli elections. But we're going to try to examine the question of principle which arises from that case. So let me give you a bit of background, which to the Israeli participants is well known, but for our foreign participants, I think it's important to give the background. Israel's election system is based on a system of proportional representation in which the competing party lists. The ultra-Orthodox parties run for election. In the last election, there were 3 ultra-Orthodox parties running, and they all exclude women from their list. There are no women candidates from their list. There have been attempts in the past to try to exclude them from the elections on this ground, that they are not democratic, but they've never been successful. So they're allowed to run when they are exclusively made up of male candidates. Just before the last elections, there were 2 groups of ultra-Orthodox women who all belong to these communities who got organized on 2 lines. The one group of women said, "Im lo nifcharot lo bocharot," if we can't be elected, we are not going to vote. So they were basically trying to pressure the ultra-Orthodox parties to include women by the threat of saying, "We're not going to vote for you, we're not going to vote for anybody else, but we're not going to vote for you." A second list, a list of all ultra-Orthodox women, said, "No, we are going to form our own list, which is going to be made up mainly of women, but not only of women, and we're going to try to run for elections and compete with the ultra-Orthodox lists," when it was quite obvious that the only potential voters are going to be members of the ultra-Orthodox communities themselves, mainly women, but hopefully some men as well. Under Israeli law, if you get enough signatures from voters to submit a list, you can submit a new list, and they submitted a new list, and they were approved for election. But they had a problem. In order to get elected, you have to campaign. And in order to campaign, you have to get access to the kind of media which is going to be available to your potential voters. And here's where you have the problem, because the same members of the ultra-Orthodox communities who are their potential voters do not have televisions. Many of them don't even listen to the radio. They don't read the general, or at least they don't admit to reading the general daily press. Internet is frowned upon by rabbis of these communities. And so where do they get their news from? From community newspapers. Most of these newspapers are aligned with the political parties which were running with only men's lists. All these newspapers said that we are subject to some kind of spiritual control, in that the rabbis can decide, or one particular rabbi or some committee can decide, whether we can publish certain items or not if we have any doubt. And so now these women had a problem. Their only form of access was to try to publish ads in these community newspapers. So what did they do? They tried to get the ads published, approached the newspapers. At first they said, "Well, we're prepared to accept them," but then they said, "Sorry, we are not publishing your ads." We'll come into the reasons that they offered a bit later. They tried to challenge this before the chairperson of the Central Elections Committee, who's a judge of the Supreme Court, but he fundamentally said, "Well, you have an alternative remedy. I can't deal with it." So a legal battle started, and Ruth will tell you about the legal battle.
So elections were to take place on March 18. The leader of this political party, Uvizkutan, her name is Ruth Kolian. She's herself a law student. She took some time before she really decided to take this attempt and challenge the whole system. Towards the end of January, she attempted to publish those paid ads in several of those ultra-Orthodox community newspapers. It took a week or 2 weeks for them, or even more than that, to refuse her. She then appealed to the Central Elections Party and was indeed refused on grounds that there is an alternative option to petition the court to have an injunction to force these newspapers to publish those ads. And it's also important to notice that Justice Jubran actually said that while he does not award them this remedy, because he does not have the power to do that and there is an alternative, still he expresses his opinion that their appeal is justified and they have valid grounds for claiming this right to force the newspapers to publish their ads. That was, his decision was given on February 18. That's exactly a month before the general elections. She then managed to find an organization to represent her at the lower court level. And as it often happens, when you start referring claimants from one court to another, that peace court again said, magistrate court, thank you, also said that it doesn't have the jurisdiction to give an injunction and it's the wrong address. So that was in March 8. And I'm going into details because that was when she approached us, meaning I'm also heading a center here at the law school for the advancement of the rights of women, the Rackman Center, and we have a legal aid clinic. And we also engage in this phenomena of exclusion of women mainly on the religious sphere. We do mainly family law, but we also deal with religious communities and exclusion of women. And I'm glad to see here two of my lawyers, Karen Horowitz and Shai Zilberberg, who actually represented Ruth Kolian. So we took on her case 2 days after she was rejected by the magistrate court. And that was 1 week before the elections. Elections were to take place on Tuesday. We took her case on Monday, the week before. By Wednesday, we had our briefings at the district court. By Thursday, there was a hearing at the district court. And on Friday, the district court judge actually accepted our appeal for a temporary injunction, which was a bit tricky. In order to get a temporary injunction, you have to prove that the temporary injunction is not identical to the main remedy. So we managed to maneuver this, and the district court judge actually accepted our arguments. He did not go into a lot of deep analysis of the conflicting claims, which we will do later, but he basically ordered, that was 1 hour before Shabbat, he gave his decision, and he ordered only one of the newspapers to publish because the other ones had already not going to issue any issues before the elections. Now, let us grant the respondents, the newspapers, the favor of believing that on Shabbat, of course, they did not do anything. But the minute Shabbat was over, they took on one of the most prestigious litigators in Israel, who appealed to the Supreme Court. We only got the request from the Supreme Court on Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock by Justice Handel. to I asked him to stay for the whole conference to hear our presentation, but apparently he has other things to do. So 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Justice Handel's tell us to respond to their request to issue an injunction to overturn, to revoke the ruling by the district court, and he gave us 2 hours to, 3 hours, was it 4, and we had to give, to submit our answers by 7. We submitted our answers by 7, and at 9 p.m. we got the decision by Justice Handel revoking the district court's order, and Justice Handel basically said that he's not going into the merits of the case, but because, and he more or less blamed Ruth Kolian, the women's, the woman leader of the Women's Party, blamed her for taking too long and for delaying all her appeals to the system, to the legal system, and by that not leaving the court enough time to delve into the very complex constitutional and rights issues that are involved in here. And since a temporary injunction is a rare remedy, and since you always have to consider the harm that would be caused by granting such an injunction, his decision is to revoke the injunction, and he sent us back home. Eventually, about 2,000 voters voted for
this party. 1,804.
Not enough to pass the threshold.
0.4%. Okay, now a personal admission. When Ruth told me about the case at the beginning in my field is constitutional law, I said, forget about it, you haven't got a chance. What, they're going to force a newspaper against their will to publish an ad? And then I started trying to develop the arguments that you could make, and suddenly I more or less persuaded myself that there was some substance to those arguments. So now I'm going to try to present both sides. Now, of course, what are the newspaper's arguments? And the newspaper's arguments are clear. First, freedom of expression. We have a lot of it. I don't have to tell Americans. But you have European Court of Human Rights, you have other judgments that a newspaper has discretion to decide what to publish and not to publish, even when it comes to paid ads. This is part of the freedom of press, part of the freedom of expression, and you're not going to be able to force him to publish something, especially in a political context in which they say this is against the political policy. We support a special political policy, and especially when some of these newspapers are party newspapers, and one of the arguments in the lower courts was, what, how can you even think of such a notion? We're a party newspaper of, say, the Shas party, and you're trying to tell us that we have to publish a paid advert for somebody who's competing against Shas in the elections? Doesn't wash. As you'll see, I think there is a counter argument to that, but I more worried about the second argument, which was not made very strongly in this case. And Shai, you'll correct me if I'm wrong, but it wasn't made very strongly in this case. But the argument was still that publishing this ad would be against the halakha. And because we are a religious newspaper, we act according to the halakha, we have a spiritual kind of advisors who've said, you can't do this, then how can you force us to publish something which would be a violation of our religious principles? Why was it against the halakha? Now, there are two possible arguments. The one they did not make. The one possible argument, which conceivably they could have made, that it's against the halakha for women to run for elections. Women should be in the home and they shouldn't be running for elections. They did not make that argument. But as part of our argument, I'm going to say, now what would have happened if they would make that argument? And we go back to the question which we've dealt with here. It's not for me to say whether that's my view of the halakha it's sufficient that they have a sincere belief that that's their view of the halakha to make it a religious issue. The argument that they made in the specific case that was part of the platform of this group, of Ruth Kalyan's group, was incompatible with the halakha. She made some suggestions as changes in the rabbinical courts, and that's, they said that was incompatible with the halakha, and so we couldn't change it. What are the counter arguments? Now this involves us in Israeli constitutional law. And some people may be smiling, Israeli constitutional law, you don't have a constitution, but we do have a part of a constitution. And our basic law, the Knesset, in Article 4 says that the Knesset elections will be inter alia equal. And that is an entrenched clause, meaning that it cannot be changed unless you have a law passed by a majority, an absolute majority of Knesset members. And that clause has been one of the main basis for the development of Israeli constitutional law. Because the first case in Israel in which the court exercised judicial review of a parliamentary statute related exactly to that law. And what was that case? And excuse me for going into the details of two cases which are quite important because I think they are relevant. That case was a case of the first time that a financing law had been passed to finance parties competing in the elections. But the law provided financing only for parties which were represented in the outgoing elections and not for new lists. And some member of the public, a lawyer from Tel Aviv, took the case to the Supreme Court and said that violates equal elections. The Attorney General waived all his formal arguments, and he could have made a lot of formal arguments because he was convinced that he's going to win on the merits. And what was his argument? What does equal elections mean? One person, one vote. And so that's it. We're not violating that. The court said no. Equal elections also means equal in opportunity. And that if you provide financing only for participating lists or for lists which are already represented but not for new lists, it's a violation of the notion of equality of opportunity in the right to be elected. And therefore, that law was invalidated. It subsequently was repassed with some financing for new parties and also with an absolute majority. Another case which is highly relevant, once again, related to campaigning this time. And here we have public broadcasting system in which by law each party participating in the elections is allotted a certain amount of time on television and on radio for political broadcasting before the elections. And the time allotted is according to the relative strength of the parties in the outgoing Knesset. But they also made an allotment, as they had to do for new parties. And just before the elections, they suddenly changed the law and they reduced the time given to the new parties and kind of extended the time given to the existing parties. And the new parties went to court. And here it was a difficult thing because there was nothing that said that the old system of how they'd allocated the time was somehow written in stone or that that was equal. They were not giving equal time to all lists. But the court said, and this is the important thing, you have to give each party the possibility of presenting its platform to the public. And if you do not give them sufficient time to at least put across their candidates and their platform, this is a violation of the principle of equal elections. Now, clearly, in these cases, we are both talking about, number one, public financing. We're talking about public television. And in the case here, we're talking about private newspapers. But still, our argument is that without access, in actual fact, without access to the community the papers in this case, the very possibility of this list of competing on any kind of equal basis in the elections is totally frustrated. They have no chance whatsoever. I don't know what would have happened if they would have been able to publish their ads, how many votes would they got. They wouldn't have passed the threshold of 3.25, but they probably would have got quite a few more votes than they got, and that's created some kind of... So then, when we come down to freedom of expression, well, the court in Israel has also tied very closely the idea of participating in elections to the notion of freedom of expression. Number one, the notion of the parties which are competing to express themselves, and number two, the rights of voters to express themselves by voting for a certain party. And obviously, if I'm denied the knowledge that there is such a party for whom I can vote, then there is some kind of incursion, first of all, on my right to vote, and on my equal right to vote, and on my right to freedom of expression. Ruth is now going to be dealing with gender equality and the women's presence in the public sphere. I'll just mention that. I'll just mention the one point that's very important, because this was the basis for the judgment of the district court which issued the temporary injunction. We have a law in Israel which discriminates, which prohibits discrimination in provision of services. And there's a definition of what is a public service. And that public service includes, in Hebrew, tikshoret, which I've interpreted here as communications. You could say media. Media, I think, would be a better interpretation. Yeah. Media. There is an exclusion in the law when you say that the service is, by its very nature, it would not be discriminatory to exclude a certain person. But the district court judge, fundamentally relying on other decisions and without very widely reasoning his opinion, said, well, by not allowing them to publish, you're discriminating against this, this is a violation of this law, and so he issued the injunction. Okay, let's go to Ruth now for the gender equality, then I'll come back to mine.
Okay. So in terms of gender equality, and we're now explaining the position of the Women's Party, I started to think about this and maybe giving some kind of a title that not all equality grounds are in fact equal. Claiming for gender equality is a special case of equality claims because of the pervasive and systematic nature of gender discrimination, because women are subordinated as a class in every community. We talked before Mikhail's lecture about a minority within the minority, and it came up yesterday also when talking about the session of that dealt with gender equality. It is a recurring pattern, and these women always find themselves in a kind of intersectional discrimination when being a woman in any community does not allow you the same opportunity and the same recourses as being a person of the opposite gender. And we have to bear this in mind when we are examining the Women's Party's claim for equality. We have to bear in mind the larger context of Israeli society, where the phenomena of exclusion of women had been systematically, gradually growing, going in very one clear direction of more women's exclusion. And it came up in some of the questions during these 3 days as well. You have been aware of those cases of demanding for different sidewalks for women in the public sphere, and you are aware of the exclusion of women from public transportation or separation of seating places. And we talked about that case of men requesting women in airplanes to step out. And my perspective, of course, the veil is also a symbol of exclusion of women's actual presence in the public sphere. So it is a clear pattern of pervasive and systematic phenomena of exclusion of women from the public sphere, and it is also systematically the fact that religion plays substantive ground for justifying this phenomena of exclusion of women. And again, that was our discussion throughout these 3 days. Now, under international law, it is the duty of the state to respect, protect, and fulfill the rights, human rights, including the right for equality, and I will not go into all the sources that have been repeatedly saying that religion cannot be a justification for gross violation of women's rights to equality, especially when it comes to the public sphere, especially when it comes to holding positions within political parties or trying to influence, again, the public sphere and the public policy. And there had been cases under European Court of Human Rights dealing with these clashes when it comes to political parties. And we also have to bear in mind, going back to the Israeli context, that these religious justifications for exclusion of women, they penetrate the general public sphere, and it's a kind of a diffusion. Public in general starts to adopt these excuses and these justifications for excluding women. You see this very well within the Israeli army when there are clashes between the growing number of observant soldiers, male soldiers, who are claiming their right to be free of the presence of female soldiers in their units or as instructors and so on and so forth. And you see that in other fora as well. So all this has to be taken into consideration when weighing these conflicting claims of freedom of expression of the press on the one hand and freedom of their religious exercise, again, of the press on the one hand, vis-a-vis the women's right to equality, to equally participate in the public sphere, especially when it comes to equal opportunity in participating in the general elections.
Okay, so just to kind of complete on that, we see that when it comes down to freedom of expression, and here I'm less worried than when it comes to freedom of religion, there's a clash of freedom of expression of both parties over here. Obviously, if I force the newspapers to publish an ad which they don't want to publish, I am somewhere restricting their freedom of expression. But on the other hand, if I deny the women the chance of getting their view across to anybody and deny them what is essentially a public forum, then in the context of elections, and we've made this quite clear, and Ruth made it quite clear, in the specific context of elections, I would say that the freedom of expression and the interest that we have in protecting equality of elections is to be preferred and outweighs the autonomy of the editors of the newspaper in deciding that they won't carry the ad. I will add, and I think you were well aware of this, that even if there had been a injunction, the likelihood of the newspapers complying with that injunction was very, very low. My assessment was that they wouldn't have complied, and they would have been prepared to face contempt of court for not complying, but we don't know.
And as lawyers, we knew that, of course.
We knew that, but...
But as cause lawyers, we obviously wanted to have this decision by the court, and our celebration of the district court decision, unfortunately, was very, very short-lived, but that Shabbat we did celebrate.
But I also want to stress, we are not making a general argument that in any case, if you want to publish in a newspaper before the elections, any newspaper has to carry your ad, obviously. And I know that if I were the editor of the newspaper, I would not publish the ads from certain of the parties, probably from the parties which excluded these people in these elections, and I would have gone to jail rather than publishing them. But the specific problem is here is that they had no alternative access. So this is the only real vehicle. I think it's much more problematical when we come down to freedom of religion. Because, and I once again, what a attitude if I say the very participation of women is compatible with the halakha, so you can't force us to publish the very existence of this list. or that part of the party platform is against the halakha. And I suggest, we both suggest in this context, that we make the following distinction, a distinction well known in the theory of freedom of expression, not so much in freedom of religion. And that is, first of all, the view that the party platform is not compatible with the halakha is not sufficient grounds for denying me the right to publish my existence. If, as opposed to a direct call, if I were to say I'm now using your newspaper in order to directly call for the members of the public not to keep the Shabbat or to eat unkosher food or not to keep the purity of the family or whatever it happens to be, that they could deny. But the mere fact that they say that in our view your platform is not compatible with the halakha is not a strong enough reason. The problem is a problem of form. And this I don't know if you've seen, but after the last elections, we had the government in there where there were three women members. And the Haredi newspapers, these very same newspapers, published photos in which they'd photoshopped out the women entirely or the faces of the women because their policy... Sorry?
Left their legs.
Some of them.
But they wore pants, so you couldn't actually tell that...
The skirt, it was hilarious.
But in some of them, so that the general policy is that they do not publish pictures of women in the newspapers, in advertisements, and that they're non-sexist. Because in most other newspapers, I've never been able to realize why I can't use a washing machine. Only women can buy washing machines. But if when I read the Haredi papers, I can buy a washing machine because the only men are buying washing machines. But still, they don't allow the publication of the pictures of women. Now, if Ruth Kalyan had come along and said, you know, you've got to publish me, I'm the candidate, there they could have said no, because it's a matter of form, not of substance, and the actual publication would have been against the halakha. But that's how we leave it at the moment. We're still thinking about it, and we'd be very interested in any comments.
And I just want to add that when we make this distinction, as David said, that the first argument that saying your platform does not abide by my understanding of halacha, that's not a sufficient ground. But if there would be a direct call to violate the halacha, that might have been a sufficient ground. This really takes the court into the content of religion and religious precepts, and we discussed it before, earlier today. So we do advocate that this is something that the court should be doing, but we see no other choice for that. Also, there had been some calls throughout these days that litigation and courts should not be the venue for solving these or resolving these conflicts. But I think that this case, this particular woman, this particular group of women, absolutely has no other recourse but the court, but litigation. And sadly, the court system had failed them this time, and it was Justice Handel who preferred formalism and formal reasons here. And as we all know, when you adhere to formalism and you stay with the status quo, you always strengthen those who already are in power, and it always works against the weaker side, and maybe we'll help it to be changed next time.
Just a question of clarification. So you suggest that they'll force each and every Haredi newspaper to publish their ads?
No,
there are several.
They choose. And if they choose...
They want everyone to...
Every one of these newspapers that would have to carry a fairly neutral ad from them, just putting across the fact that they exist and what their fundamental platform is, yes, they would have to publish it.
Okay, let's open up for discussion. Michael, please.
Just a curiosity question and then something about kind of the argument at the end of there. So in under Israeli, I guess, basic law or constitutional law, so if my religion says I can't do X, therefore I have the freedom of religion claim, is there a standard under what circumstance, get to Trump, and like we were talking before, in the United States also, there could be a common government interest. What's the standard in Israeli constitutional law for what you need to beat a freedom of religion?
Well, we don't have a protection of freedom of religion as such in the actual constitution. And one of the cases we do have in the Declaration of Independence, a statement that Israel promises freedom of religion and conscience. And this came up originally with the marriage law in Israel that says that all Jews in Israel must be married according to Jewish religious law. And secular Jewish couples applied to the Supreme Court and said this is a violation of our freedom of religion and conscience. And the court, and it was a very secular judge, one of the most secular judges who'd ever sat on the Supreme Court, Justice Berenson, and he said, in this case, it's true, this is a violation of your freedom of conscience, but there's nothing I can do about it because there's an Israeli statute on that case. Now, things have changed since then because we now have the basic law on human dignity and liberty. That does not specifically mention freedom of religion. You spoke about dignity, but the court has said, well, dignity certainly includes part of freedom of religion. But in order to exercise judicial review of a statute, it would have to be a statute passed after that law came into effect. And so it becomes highly problematical. But the theory would be that they would judge it under the limitations clause in that law, which is, when it comes down to it, it's a proportionality analysis. Balancing.
Right. The second question I had was more a substantive question. The distinction between the platform and, so the newspaper runs an ad that said, somebody wants to run an ad that says, don't keep Shabbat, you think that would be a non-starter. But if I say, vote for me, and somewhere else I said, don't keep Shabbat, that would be okay. I guess
I say that even within the context of a political advert, you can't say I'm running for elections in order to persuade people don't keep the Shabbat. That would not be legitimate, because that would be indirectly calling for people. But that was not the case. I'm suggesting,
But we would not even get to this question, because this hypothetical example, if we're thinking about whom would be the possible runner for this party, they would not find themselves in the same impossible situation of this women's party. Their constituents would not be only those religious women or men, ultra-Orthodox women or men, who are not exposed to any other media channels for getting the information about this hypothetical party running for elections. We're talking here about a very, very particular specific case, and I don't think we could think of other circumstances that would really combine all this together.
I guess maybe I should just then ask another clarification question. That last thing that you had on the last slide, that said substance, and then there was one thing that you said was, I think it said, one thing is okay and one thing is not okay. What was the
What I said, well, if I'm just putting across the party platform, and I say this is what I believe in, this is the party platform, that's okay. If I have a direct call to people to violate the halakha, that they could say no. So in this case, if I said, look, I believe in the reform, in the laws dealing with the jurisdiction of the rabbinical courts, and they think that the jurisdiction is absolutely fine, and any change maybe against the halakha, that's not good enough. But if I were to say I'm running for election and I'm going to call for all voters now just to go out on Shabbat and to violate the Shabbat, they could say, no, that part of your platform we're not publishing.
This distinction is taken from what? It's your distinction.
Yeah.
My attempt to dance around the question and find some kind of credible way in which I can find a balance, can find a balance between what we recognize. And I'm not trying to undermine the questions. I don't feel very comfortable about the idea that you're forcing a newspaper to publish something that they don't want to, but you've got a balance.
And it's not an absolute distinction.
Okay, Rex, please.
Coming out of left field, this seems to be like from the point of view of antitrust, the competition law example of a very unusual market because we've got a market where the basically a monopoly supplier of a particular kind of service of election communications. There are no substitutable media or radio, TV, so they hold a monopoly position. Mm-hmm. If you define the market that way. Now, I know there is competition. I'm not familiar with the monopolization section, but it might well prima facie fall within that.
Certainly,
I'm not even charging for this.
You can.
And the other thing is, in the English common law and also throughout the British common law, there's a doctrine of prime necessity. It goes way back centuries. Now, if a particular owner has a prime necessity, a wharf or a turnpike or something, but under the common law, they had to share that on reasonable access. I can't remember the names of the cases, but I could look them up. And I don't know if that English common law principle applies in Israel, but that's another entire cause of action or doctrine that you could turn to.
Thank you. Okay. We'll ask for references.
No. Right.
Okay. Michael?
Yeah. Well, what I was hearing here in the subtext is something very similar to what I was trying to argue, is that liberalism wouldn't put or juxtapose against communitarianism. Let's suppose that communitarianism in this case is the antithesis. You're making the judgment that I'm going with liberalism even if it comes under account of this community identity which is preserved, and therefore this is exactly what I was trying to say, that liberalism is a kind of a dictatorship, in a sense that we follow liberalism and we are imposing what liberalism. That's the move here.
I don't agree with you.
I'll
tell you why I don't agree with you.
No, let's take another case, which I think is even more parties that don't allow women to be on their lists, okay? And let's say, would the Knesset be able to say you cannot discriminate against women when you are forming a list? Just
yes.
Like you cannot have a party running for the Knesset and denying the Jewish identity of the
right.
State of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think they could.
But
politically,
it was denied by the court.
Politically, it's not possible to pass such a thing, but I don't think that on any grounds of principle I could deny a law which exists in many countries, in which you say that on any list there has to be a certain percentage of women.
Mm-hmm.
It would be fine. I'll tell you why I don't agree with you. I don't agree with you on two grounds. The number one, we are not talking about generalism. We are talking about the political process. We do have a democratic process, and I have to try to guarantee the integrity of that process. And the integrity of that process means that everybody who is entitled to vote has access to the possibilities. And number two, that every party which is voting, is running for elections, has a possibility of putting itself across to the potential voters. Okay, that's not necessarily part of a liberal democracy, it's just part of any democratic process. You could have the same democratic process in a fairly non-liberal country.
And I just want to add here that bringing up the claim of communitarism, it's difficult for me to accept because I am very skeptical and I'm very doubtful about this claim for community coherence and community integrity when it is a very specific class within the community, the male class within the community, that decides what are the community's characteristics here. And I'm not sure that I want to protect, you know, it's the old multicultural feminist dilemma. So this is one expression of this dilemma, and I always side with the
feminist critique. So you want
the
state
feminist
to force liberalism on every and each community.
Yeah.
You don't
yes,
allow the community autonomy
when,
to decide. They
when
don't
it,
want
when
to
it
be
comes
liberal.
To gender
they want
equality,
to be, though, I mean,
when it
them,
comes to gender equality, I
so
do.
Why just gender
not,
equality? What about freedom? And what about same-sex marriage? What about, you know, many different issues? They want to choose.
So,
they don't respect autonomy the same as you respect. They don't respect freedom the same. They have their own vision. Why should the state impose its own values on and their priorities.
That's why I started by saying that gender equality is a unique case of equality claim and of a value of principle. It is different from other principles,
not for Orthodox, and I don't think you have the right to impose your own priorities upon them. I mean, for them, they have their own freedom, and I really run away from this dictatorship. And for political liberalism, not for comprehensive liberalism. Okay. So if you support comprehensive liberalism, you get into dictatorship. I mean, we have, of course, I think, to remain within the boundaries of political liberalism in order not to violate freedom.
But Chaim, just to one, that's why in this specific article, we are restricting it to the political process, because the community is not insulated. It's participating in the political process. The political parties are running for the political, they're running in the general elections, and on the other hand, they're using their force in order to exclude members of their own community, not from community affairs, but from actually participating in the general elections. That they can't do.
No, it's too bad. So they have to establish their own papers, go to Sheldon...
their own elections.
To Sheldon...
Their own sovereign state.
So establish a newspaper for ultra-Orthodox women and publish on the street. I mean, you have channels. You don't have to...
No.
Of course that you have. I mean, raise money and establish a newspaper.
Very realistic option.
Okay, Suzanne.
Now, I mean, look, this is a pattern of cases that are really fascinating, which is the attempt to use the court system to reform one's own community, right, without leaving one's community,
right?
Right? That you want to remain inside the community, but you want to reform it, and say we use the outside court system as a kind of lever, right, that allows you to do it. Which always puts, whether we have these in the Native American cases in terms of membership rules, we have it in the Agunot cases in America, which is really fascinating from this perspective. And I'm trying to ask myself really, I mean, I think this is a very important question as to what, you know, where do you place the court, right? But how does the court place itself? And it always seems to me when I listen to this here in some way, as opposed to thinking about these cases in the American context, there is this dilemma, wholly apart from the question of comprehensive liberalism versus political liberalism, that there's this added dilemma in Israel, in some fashion, of not wishing to place the court system, not wishing to place itself in some way as its own culture. Right? Just somehow not willing to place itself as its own culture. And yet, when courts do place themselves as their own culture, saying as David argues, look, right, these are just democratic principles, that's it. It's not that I want to reform you, it's not that I want you to be liberal. These are just democratic principles, that's the end of the story. At that point, you know, you have movement because you have a clash. And things happen as a result. And so it seems to me that there's a benefit from not taking this comprehensive liberal position, very much so, because it then allows for some sort of exchange and change that is in some ways less threatening. So Michal's position about comprehensive liberalism here worries me a little bit on the one hand. On the second, it's always interesting to me to observe here again, also as an outside observer, the kind of something like Mandel's position here, which seems so tentative, so unable in some way to just do something that would be relatively simple from a pure democratic perspective that would allow for some movement. So what seems to go on in some way is an extra level of added protection, right? A kind of protectivism that I'm not sure I totally understand where it's coming from. I think
you're striking a very right chord, or maybe even a raw nerve on the part of the judiciary, especially the Supreme Court, the High Court of Justice, who's taking a very restrictive attitude, especially in issues of religion and state in recent years after Barak stepped down, and Cheshin and Prokatia, and probably Justice Handel's decision is a reflection of this attitude, and you're framing it in a very correct manner that if they had done otherwise, it would probably backfire. And they don't want to risk losing legitimacy. but I think that while we are narrowing down our discussion and our proposal to the very narrow context of the elections and the democratic process, as we emphasized at the end of our talk, I think that the decision should have gone otherwise, and it should be a very incremental process. But we should have been able to pass this stage in this incremental process.
Okay, thank you very much.